You are the maker of the universe, Yahweh. Jesus. Hallelujah. And maybe you've come here tonight and there's some burdens that you're carrying. There's some worry, there's doubts, there's things on the back of your mind that you, it's just weighing you down right now. Understand that the Word of God says that you can come to God, come as you are to the throne of grace. He is calling you, the King is calling you. Come as you are with your flaws, with your worries, with your doubt, and put it at the foot of Jesus right now. and maybe you're struggling with sickness in your life. Maybe it's financial issues. Maybe it's issues within the family. Maybe you need some restoration within your family. Maybe there's some mental health issues where you are thinking badly about yourself, or where you've had thoughts of depression and suicide. Understand that God wants to give you breakthrough right now. He wants to give you the mind of Christ. He wants to give you that breakthrough in your finance, in your family, in your health, in every single sphere of your life. So what we're going to do right now is that we're going to pray and we're going to trust in God for a supernatural work. But you got to have the faith. You got to believe. You got to take a stand and believe that it will be done for you. When we say amen, it says, let it be done. It's not just a religious word that we say, that we speak in Christianese. It is done. We receive it right now. So we're going to pray right now. And I want you right there to, if you want to, say amen. But say it, believing that it is done. Right? So we're going to pray. And Heavenly Father, thank you, Jesus. Every single person struggling with sickness, oh God, we apply your blood upon their lives. Thank you, Lord, that by your blood they're redeemed. They are cleansed, forgiven, justified, and sanctified. Thank you, Lord, that you are wounded for their transgressions. You were bruised for their iniquities. It just hasn't of the peace of the punishment. By the stripes of Jesus, they are healed. Thank you, Lord, that you may heal every mind, every single broken heart, every single broken family, oh God. I pray for financial breakthrough, that they may receive a seat abundantly above more than can ever ask, think, or even imagine. Thank you, Jesus, that you can make your way this December, Lord, that no one will fall back, that you may keep them. My prayer is that you may keep them, oh God, that they may not go back, that they may not fall short of your glory, oh God, but then they may have a thirst for you and a hunger for you, Jesus, that they may have that passion to know more of you, oh God. Help us, Jesus, change our minds that we may have the mind of Christ. We need you, Lord. We are dependent on you. And right there we are, just start speaking to the Lord right now. We need you, Jesus. Just start surrendering to him right now. We are depending on you. We are nothing without you, Jesus. We can't do this by ourselves. We can't do December on our own terms, oh God. We need you, Lord. We need you, Jesus. And right there where you're at, we are going to just give Jesus a big shout of praise. And when you give that praise, I want you to believe that what you've been trusting in God for, it is done. Amen. It is done. I receive it, right? Amen. Come on, let's give Jesus a big shout of praise. We praise you, Lord. He said it, so it is done. He said it, so it is done. All you need to do is believe. Amen? Amen? It is done. Amen. And you guys can just take your seats right there. Thank you so much. The Vault Music. You guys are awesome. And I just want to welcome everyone by way of streaming, everyone online, everyone in the building. Hello. And I'm going to actually mention some of the people streaming, some of the campuses, if that's cool. So we got Alberton. Hello, Alberton. Welcome, welcome. We have Oliven. All right. And you can give the round of applause at the end. And we have Polokwane. Yes. All right. We have Nigel streaming in on us. And we have Wolfus Bay. Yes. Hello. So awesome to have you here. Welcome, welcome, welcome everyone by way of streaming. Welcome to everyone here in the building. It's a vibe, right? December vibes. All right, so if you're here for the very first time, I want to empower you. You guys can just put up your hand and make sure you fill in the form, and online, make sure that you fill in the online form so that we can connect with you, so that we can, really just chat and make sure that you are connected to the family of God, because that's what it's all about. Loving God, loving people, yes sir. So before we get into an amazing service, I just want to share some announcements. So we have something really amazing happening for the woman, for the ladies, for the girls tomorrow. Do you guys know what it is? Ladies Encounter! Hey! All the ladies say hey! Hey! All right, so make sure you don't miss out on that. It's going to be awesome. And next week, Sunday, 2 p.m., we have, and they're going to show it on the screen, IP Takeover. I'm getting ready for war. Hey! All right, yes, right there. Ready for war, IP Takeover. So for our December rally, the IPs are going to take over the stage, right? We're going to give them the space to really just have an awesome December rally, and make sure you don't miss out on that, and stay tuned for that for more information as well. And we have an amazing service jam-packed. Are you guys ready for it? Are you feeling the December vibes? All right, awesome. If you are excited, won't you just also comment there? Just some excited emojis, you know, the dancing emoji and like the glasses emoji and any other emoji that you like. One of the streamers, my favorites. And so we're about to get into the rest of the service. And won't you just help me count down the highlights clip in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hoo-ha.
Can we get a hoo-ha?
Catch that. My Redeemer, he lives.
Yes, sir.
Lives, thank you for the music. That's
yes,
always
sir.
On top as always. Yes,
yes sir.
Sir.
Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir.
Oh, Dimby Cakes.
Today I'm the yes, sir, man.
They don't know the boy.
Forget Tristan. Welcome.
You are here.
And it's happening. Right
now.
Here.
Right here.
Yes,
right
sir.
Now. Why? Why?
We cover everything from the blood of identity.
Oh!
I feel.
We have baptism! Oh my God!
Make another meme out of this. It's beautiful. Look at my brothers up there.
That, y'all missed a great time to say amen.
I'm not gonna say anything stupid today. No? If you guys, you guys having fun? Yes? You don't look like it.
That there are things that are the secrets of God, that are hidden in God, that are so big, that are so enormous and so far above human understanding that we cannot know them. God is. Only God can reveal himself to us. Hallelujah.
Amen. Mic test 1, 2. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. There we go. There we go. Amen. Are you guys good? Everyone in the auditorium, are you guys okay? Are you good? Are you having fun? Okay. Everyone online would like to welcome you once again to the vault service. Can everyone just give a shout unto God today in the auditorium? Let's go. Amen. Praise the Lord Jesus. Amen. Yes. And we're just going to give our tithes and offerings to God. And, you know, throughout these weeks, we've been speaking about generosity. You know, Pastor Bert has been sharing a powerful message. And I know, I think, was it 2 weeks ago? 2 weeks ago, we had the fruits on stage and everything like that. That was really a visual, a good representation of, you know, what it means to be generous and what God really does within our lives. And today, I just want to read out of the book of 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6. And it's the verse about being a cheerful giver. And I know in church we always say, you know, who's a cheerful giver, right? We always say that in church, right? Right? Everyone in the auditorium, everyone online, are you a cheerful giver? Awesome stuff. But it says in 2 Corinthians 9 verse 6, but this I say, who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And what I know from what I see from this verse is one word that is really, it made itself very clear to me, is purpose. In giving, you know, God has called us to live a life of purpose, of course, to win souls and make disciples. But in this verse, it speaks about purpose in giving. That when you give, it has to be out of purpose, not out of necessity, not out of, you know, I'm too scared to give. And right now, it might be a tough time even because we're going into December. So when I say, you know, give God a loud shout of praise and who's a cheerful giver, the praises are not as loud as, you know, it maybe mid-year or, you know, because we're going into December and it's the month where we're saving, you know, it's the month where we really want to have fun, you know, as teenagers, as varsity students, we really want to have fun because it's December. So you save up, you September, October, November, you save up for December, then you get to a place where you wonder why you're worrying in January. Because you did not bring purpose in your giving. That's your problem. So I realized, personal testimony, I realized when I was looking at my bank statements and everything, so I would give my offering, I would give everything to God, I'll budget and everything, then, but I wouldn't budget to the T. I wouldn't invite God after my tithes and offerings to, you know, what he has given me, the 90 that he has given me, or the 80 that he has given me. I wouldn't invite God to that. There was no purpose in how I was budgeting, hence why there was like a hole in my bank account. I look at my statements and I see airtime, and I'm wondering, wait, what is going on? How am I losing this amount of money because of, I don't know, airtime, Burger King, McDonald's, or, you know? Because there's no purpose in your giving. You give out of necessity, and that's what the Bible tells you not to do. Don't give because you're scared, but give out of faith. Make sure you budget in December so you don't get to January and your pockets are empty and you can't give anything to God because of your lack of purposefulness in your giving. So make sure even in December, you budget properly. God has given you 90 not to just spend, but to make sure that you plan, you purpose your budgeting, you purpose your giving. Amen? Yo, the amens are quiet. The amens are so quiet because, like, see, I wanted to buy shoes in December. Don't tell me that. Purpose in your giving, even in December, so you can reach January, you know, and you know, don't need to worry. It's not January, it's January. Amen. Amen. So, right now, as you give, trust in God, give out of purpose, plan to give. And it goes with the message of generosity that we've been hearing. You need to make sure that you give out of purpose, not because you see the Masasedi videos, you see people, you know, in the shacks or people, you know, in different places of their lives and everything. It's a blessing where you are. The fact that you're able to watch online means that you have Wi-Fi or data connection, means that God has blessed you. It's a blessing where you are. The fact that you're able to come today in that vehicle outside, it's a blessing. There's other people who don't have that. So appreciate where you are, but have a heart of generosity. Be a cheerful giver. So where you are, we're going to give unto God right now. You're going to give your tithes and your offerings to God out of purpose, not because you're scared. We're going to trust in God, and it's going to multiply. The windows of heaven will multiply, and your life will open, and God will bless you and your family. And where you are, just hold your tithes and offering, or maybe it's on your phone or EFT, and we're going to just pray. Everyone just close your eyes in the auditorium. There we have it. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for who you are and what you continue to do within our lives. Thank you that right now, as we give, we can give out of purpose, Lord God. Not out of necessity, not because we're scared or fearful, Lord God, but we give knowing that, Heavenly Father, Lord, we plan, Heavenly Father, Lord, we plan to give knowing that you shall, Heavenly Father, Lord, provide for us, Lord God. We give because, Heavenly Father, we know that the storehouse needs to be, Heavenly Father, Lord, blessed, that the people of Heavenly Father, Lord, of your church need to, Heavenly Father, Lord, receive the word and continue to grow in the name of Jesus. So thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord, for today. Thank you that we're able to be here to be blessed, Lord God, so you can continue to, Heavenly Father, to work and move within our lives in the name of Jesus. So right now, as we give unto you, bless it in the name of Jesus. Let it multiply 5, 10, 50, 100-fold, Lord God, so we can, Heavenly Father, Lord, let our pockets, let our bank accounts be a representation of who you are within our lives in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Are you ready to give? Log on to my3c.tv for cashless donations. Made safe, made simple, made smart. Choose your donation option. Enter your amount and press pay now. Choose one of our easy and convenient payment methods and you're good to go. You can give via credit or check card, instant EFT, or the MasterPass option. My3c.tv, cashless donations. Made safe, made simple, made smart. Fix your eyes on the screen for the QR code.
Hi, family. We're here in Mpiliswini in the Tokoza in Johannesburg, South Gauteng. And we are handing out food here. This is our second day. And we've handed close to 3,000-4,000 packets of parcels to people. And we're going to be doing over 20,000 in this area. This area, let me tell you, the poverty is hectic. People are really yearning, crying out just for food to eat. And the joy that there is when they receive the food is immense. And as you can see, this place, there is poverty like you can't believe. So once again, what a privilege to be able to be such a blessing. And I want to say thank you to all the sponsors. I want to say thank you to everybody contributing, all the volunteers. It's as a team together that that makes this possible, that we're able to do what we are doing at the moment. And we want to say thank you. We really appreciate you. We're glad to have incredible people that are helping us and giving us the security we needed. We have from the South African Police Force, Police Services, we have Sergeant Mashiani. We've got Sergeant Mashiani that's joining us. Sergeant, we want to say thank you. We really appreciate it. What is your feeling on what's going on here?
Thank you so much, gentlemen, because what you are doing to our community is very good indeed. And then with me, I have Induna, the people who live in this hostels.
Yes, yes.
Now they are very happy with the food, and I think this project will be continuously
yes.
with our community around, so
yes.
that we will fight with poverty, because poverty is the cause of the crimes that we
yes.
are coming across around the our area.
Yes,
so we
yes.
thank you so much, and then we thank God
yes.
because I think you sent by God to us.
Yes, we also like to thank the church to come and give us what the people need, because of now if people are happy, then it's going to be a good December for them, so they can see that they are not alone. God is still with them. Yes, we thank you.
Awesome. So once again, thank you. You can see everybody working together to make a difference.
So ufuna ukuthini kula bafundisi abakunikezela ukudla manje?
Lukini, ngiyababonga. Unkulunkulu ababusise kakhulu. Abasani bamandise lo akuthathe khona.
Hayi gama, my name is Ayanda Mboni. I'm living there. Impilo inzima, siyazama ukumaketha sithini sithini kunzima nje, sidala singadlanga. Message engifuna ukunikeza umfundisi ukuthi keep on yonke into ekho, yonke into ayenzile siyayithanda, siyayijabulela. Unkulunkulu ambosise. Thank you very much.
What an awesome day we've had here as the Mahlasedi Foundation in Thokoza, Johannesburg South, and what an incredible time we've had. What wonderful people are here. What a community there is here. They are excited that we could come and just remember them, even in this difficult time, to continue to give them hope and to never give up. Your contribution has brought us this far, and we are excited to be here in Thokoza, loving God and loving the people of Thokoza. We say thank you. God bless you. The future beams with hope.
Amen. Can we give God a huge round of applause for that, for just what he's been doing in this nation through the Mahlasedi team? Are you guys excited to be here? Amen, amen. So welcome to the service. And obviously, I am not Euphrasia, in case you haven't caught on. Just asking if you can please excuse her. She was not feeling well. And speaking about Euphrasia, today is the one-year anniversary that Frey and Tristan have been married. Yes, yes, I'm so excited. They are, look, I am their cell brother, so it's been quite a journey with them, but really they are just incredible, incredible, incredible people. I've never met anyone with as much heart, as much passion for Christ, for God, and just for youth in general. And that makes it awkward, because now I really want to honor my pastors, Pastor Pearson and Pastor Blessing, just for the incredible example. Even Pastor Bern, Pastor Shanae, look, I think a lot of people come up and say this, but me, I can actually count all the times I've just come with nonsense to all of them. Every single time. But just the patience and the love they've shown towards me over these years has just been incredible. So Yeah, we're really grateful for Pastor Bird, Pastor Nay, Pastor Pearson, Pastor Blessing. You are the best. I love you. I don't say it much, but I'm saying it today. I love you. I appreciate you. And right there where you are, God bless you, your family, and may you continue to multiply you. So we're going to get straight into the word today. But before we do that, let's just pray. Father God, we thank you for who you are. Father, we thank you that we're not here by our own merit, by our own accord, but Father, it is by your grace, by your mercy, by your favor. And Father, today we pray that may you minister to each and every single one of us, Father. May your word do what you have set it out to do, Father, in Jesus' name, amen and amen. And before I forget, let me greet all the campuses. We have Alberton joining us tonight. Give it up for Alberton. We have Olivan that is joining us right there where you are. Right there where you are, Olivan. I hope you guys are having a great time right there. We have Pulukwani, the motherland. My brothers and sisters are right there. Pulukwani, we're so glad you can join us. And if Tebucho's in the building, it's actually Tebucho's birthday. Happy birthday, Pastor Tebucho. We hope you've had an incredible day. God's richest blessings on you and your family. We also have Nigel joining us tonight. Give it up for Nigel. And Valfus Bay. Valfus Bay, I believe, all the way in Namibia. We're so glad that you guys could join us. And I hope you guys are excited for the word. And as you can see, we're speaking on the spirit of generosity. And Pastor Bird, over the past, well, not last week, but the week before, well, actually last week and 2 weeks back, he preached such an incredible word on the spirit of generosity. And every time I'm up here speaking about tithes and offering, I tell you guys how much I love sermons on tithes and offering, because I think for me personally, God has taken me to such an incredible, unexplainable place when it comes to my finances. Such an unexpected, to this day, I'm still flabbergasted by what God has done for me, which is why I'm so passionate when it comes to anything. Whenever Pastor Bird speaks on tithes and offering, I am there, focused, attentive, and I'm just like, wow, wow, that's exactly what I needed. And I want to encourage you guys. So what I'm going to share today is just based on what God has been doing in my life in the past couple of weeks since Pastor Bird has ministered it. But I really want to encourage you guys to make sure that you get to the word, get to Pastor Bird's YouTube, get to the 3C app, and really hear this word for yourself. It is very crucial that you grasp this. It is so crucial, because often when we're young, when we're at this, I say this like I'm one of you and I'm at your age, but when you're in high school, or when you just got out of high school and you're looking at finances and you're thinking about finances, it's not necessarily a big deal until you're the one eating noodles every single day. It's not a big deal until you realize that, I really like this girl and I'd love to get married to her, but you realize that love by itself is not enough. Something's got to pay the rent. So often at times, and here's the thing, forgive me, please don't kick me off the stage, but here's the thing, especially with Christians, we get so excited about stuff. We get so fired up and pumped up about stuff, but yet we need to remember that stuff costs money. It's not just going to happen. It's not just going to happen. And for me, I found myself at that place where I was like, hold up, wait a minute. Listen, God, I got plans. I got stuff I want to do. I got stuff I need to get done. I got some dreams in the future, and I don't know how I'm going to do this. And here's the thing. For me to openly admit this is a shock. Because anyone who knows me, like CEO over there who's operating the camera, I think I actually went out for lunch with him once, and I told him this. No, we were driving somewhere. And I told him this, and I told him, this is what I'm dealing with. This is what I'm going through. I want to do this, this, this. I'm looking at this, this, this. Listen, I'm trying to buy a house. I'm trying to do this. I'm freaking 27. I got to get stuff done, but I don't know where this money is going to come from. And Sia looked at me, and he was shook to his core, because he's like, I have never in the
I think we've known each other for, what, 8 years now? He's like, I've never, in the 8 years I have been with Baal, heard him speak like this. But that was my reality. That's where I found myself. And then there was a day, I remember this day, it was the last day of the women's conference, a Thursday. I went to my pastor. Listen, for obvious reasons, I can't tell you the stuff that I'm dealing with and I'm trying to get done. But I went to my pastor, I said, Pastor, I'm dealing with this. I'm trying to do this. I want to do this. And I was tearing up. Listen, I am Tsonga. I am black. I am from Limpopo. The only time we cry is when our parents deposit millions. But I was crying as I was talking to my pastor. I was saying, Pastor, I don't know how I'm going to do this. I want to do this. But here's the thing. As I'm speaking to you now, I'm not trying. I don't want to come from a place where I have doubt and I have faith. I have fear. But the truth is, this is the reality of my life. This is where I'm at, and I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know what I'm going to do. Then my pastor was silent for a bit. At first, I thought it was him being deep, but I think it was him trying to figure out what to say. Then he looked at me, and he said, okay, you have a car, right? I was like, yeah. You live in a nice place, right? I'm like, you know, I like to think so. I think about my TV, my soundbar, nice two bedrooms. I love the side tables. I love the wooden finish. I love everything. I'm an interior decorator at heart. So yeah, you know, I got all these things. Great. Your bills are paid. I'm like, yeah. Then he said, for someone at your age earning the amount that you earn, you are blessed more than most people I've ever met. And here's the thing about that blessing. The blessing didn't come with, God, I need petrol, then ching, ching, money in the, no. Because at times, that's what we Christians think. We have reached a point in our lives where we've dumbed God down to our situations. Meaning, we want God to help us the way we want Him to help us. We've stopped letting God be God. So the question is, and this is one thing I was wrestling with for my life, because when I got this, when I figured this out, then the entire script changed for me. Everything changed for me. And I'm going to share this verse with you. This one verse, this is the verse of all verses. This verse, look, you're struggling with money? This is the verse. You need Jesus? This is the verse. Your family's struggling? This is the verse. And that verse is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave. I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to leave it right there. For God so loved the world that he gave. Now, why is that? Obviously, we know he gave his begotten son, so whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Amen. We thank you, Jesus. But why is that part so important? It's because that is the very nature of who God is. That is the very representation of who God is. For God so loved the world that he gave. Who is God? He is a giver. What God does is give. The problem is we're so comfortable with God giving to us, we think that it's okay for us not to be like God. And when it comes down for me to give, suddenly it's a problem. Suddenly it's a problem. It's a huge problem. Like, God, listen, look, the giving is your part. The giving is you. It's all you. You're the one that gives. I'm just here to receive. Because it's nice to receive, ne? Ah, receiving's nice, guys. I ain't gonna lie to you. Receiving's nice. But here's the problem with just being, and this is what Pastor Bert titled last week's sermon, and the first time he preached it. It was giver versus taker, meaning are you a giver or are you a taker? And it's not giver and taker, it's giver or taker. You can't, there is no middle ground. This is what I love about God. There is no middle ground. In Revelation, it says, if you are lukewarm, I will spit you out. God is, basically what God is saying is, I'd rather prefer you to be a backslidden person than a half-hearted, one leg in, one leg out, always confused. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't know what I want the next day kind of Christian, because you're wasting my time. Because you are not who I am. God says, I am a giver. If a giver is not what you are, get out. Watch recent meme for that. He says, if a giver is not what you are, get out, because you're wasting my time. And not only are we wasting God's time, we are wasting who we are in God. So that's a question. Are we a giver or a taker? And here's the thing about Jesus. Like, we've heard this multiple times, that Jesus preached about money more than anything else. Like, we hear this all the time, right? Well, I hear it all the time. But then I was sitting, I was like, I don't really see a lot of places where Jesus preaches about money. I can think of one place off the top of my head where Jesus is always mentioning money. And I decided, let me go to that one place where Jesus mentions it. And as I was going through that today, I realized that it's just a whole chain reaction of money after money after money after money. And where I'm looking at now is Matthew 6. The first verse is in verse 24. It says, man, oh man. It says, no one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one or he will love the other. Or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, aka money. So what's Jesus saying? This is straightforward. He's saying, you in yourself, you in your hustling, you in your trying to get things together, you in your trying to make it. He says, you can't serve two masters. Choose. That's what God is saying. Choose. He says, either you're serving me or you're serving money. And the reason why God is telling you this, he's giving it to you as a warning. There's a reason why you struggle. You know what? I'm going to get back to that. I'm getting a little ahead of myself there. But he says, choose. Why? He says, you will love the one, or you will either love the one or hate the other. Listen, I never met a brother that can love his ex and his next at the same time. One of them gotta go. Verse 25. Same chapter. Verse 25. He says, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Is not life more than the money in your current bank account? Is not life more than the mansion you're trying to live in? Is not life more than the Nike Diors you're trying to cop? He says, look at the birds in the air. They don't sow, they don't reap, nor do they gather in their barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. How much more valuable are you than they? Verse 27. Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubic to your stature? Amen. Amen. I ain't done. Jesus said one more thing. Verse 33, same chapter, Matthew 6, same chapter. He says, but seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow has its own worries. Sufficient are the worries of these days. Once again, it says, seek first the kingdom of heaven, his righteousness, and all these things. What are these things? Because we talk about things in the Bible again. What are all these things? Let me take it back. Verse 25. Do not worry about what you will eat. Jesus considers what you will eat as things. Do not worry about what you will drink. Jesus considers what you're going to drink as things. What you will wear, where you will sleep, where my next school fees is going to come from. Why? Jesus looks at it as things. But what does Jesus say? When he's done with all of this, to wrap it up, what does he say? He says, seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and all these things, these little things, these trivial things, all these things will be added unto you. Y'all ain't saying amen loud enough. Y'all are clearly not understanding what I'm saying. So I'm going to do you guys a favor, and I'm going to run it back to you so that you guys get a full picture of this chapter. The reason why your ministry is struggling. You're wondering, how is he bringing it to my ministry? How? The reason why your ministry is struggling. The reason why your finances are struggling. The reason why there's struggles in your family. The reason why coming to the vault is such a mission. The reason why running your cell, getting your disciples going is such a mission is because you are not seeking the kingdom of God. Now you're looking at me and you're saying, Baal, how dare you say I'm not seeking the kingdom of God? Okay, let me ask you something. What are you worrying about today? Because you cannot both be seeking the kingdom of God and worrying at the same time. The reason why you're not seeking the kingdom of God and the reason why things are failing in your life is because there are too many worries in your life. And the reason why you are worrying, I'm going to take it back up to verse 24, is because you are serving two masters. Listen, if I was a slave, I would be worried too. If I was a slave, I would be worried about where my next paycheck comes from. I would be hectically concerned. That's why Jesus says you can't serve two masters. You can't serve both God and money. See, if you're serving God, you're seeking the things of God. Meaning, I don't have the time. Look, worrying takes time. Worrying is time consuming. Take it from someone who has worried. Worrying is time consuming. So it is impossible to be so focused and so prioritized on your worries and prioritized on the kingdom of God at the same time. That's why he says you can't serve two masters, because you will hate the one. You will hate the one. And here's the thing about hate. It's not an intentional despising of God. But the moment that the service becomes an inconvenience for you, you have hated God. The moment waking up for devotion is now work, you have hated God. The moment the phone call from your leader comes and you're just thinking about it and you're just contemplating, do I answer it? What have I done wrong? Guess what? You have hated God. That's why he says you can't serve two masters. You can't. It is impossible. It is impossible. And for some of you, the master that you're serving is the worries in your life. This is the reason why God says, test me in this. In Malachi 3 verse 10. He says, you have been cursed with a curse. And then he says, you ask, how can I return to you? Then God says, bring back the tithes and the offering. Not only does he say, bring back the tithes and the offering, he says, test me in this. The only time in the Bible, it's funny how there's a commandment in the Bible that says, you shall not test the Lord your God. But the one time God says, test me in this, it comes to your tithes and offering. Why? Because Jesus knows and Jesus understands that we get so consumed. We get so consumed with our worries. We get so consumed with our needs. We get so consumed. And here's the thing. I'm not here saying that what you're going through isn't real. I'm not here saying that you don't have problems. That there isn't stuff that you're dealing with. I'm here telling you that more than your problems, there is a God that is greater, that is bigger, that is stronger than a lot of that. This is why God says, test me in this. He says, test me in this. Not only test me and watch me. Watch me pour out a blessing that you, so much so that you will not be able to receive it. A blessing so big that you will not be able to receive it. Why does he say, test me? Because he knows. He knows that we get consumed with the troubles of the world. He knows that we get consumed with what is going on, with the happenings, with the ins and outs, whatever our family is dealing with our studies, with our finances. He knows that we get consumed with this. That's why God says, test me. And when he says, test me, it's not just test me, but it's trust me. Trust me. I was talking to a guy a little while ago, and it was a spur of the moment conversation. I think we were on Encounter, and for lunch, we went to McD's to get some food. Then as I'm about to pay the food, he gives me some money. Then I'm holding the money, and then suddenly the Holy Spirit asked me to ask him, okay, just ask him if he's tithed, or if he tithes in general. Then I look at him, I was like, hey, yo, have you tithed? He's like, no, I haven't. Then I was like, okay, why? He's like, it's really just not a priority for me. Then I was like, okay, cool, I hear you. Then I was like, okay, tell me, because you seem to have a lot of money lately, because he's telling me about how the latest iPhone is on the way to being delivered to him, about how he bought the latest QLED Samsung TV. He's telling me all of these things and the business stuff that he does, where he buys old used cars, refurbishes them and sells them, how he fixes cell phones, how he does all of these things. And I'm saying, listen, dude, you actually make quite a lot of money. And he's like, yeah, I do. I'm like, I don't mean to be rude, but every time I talk to you and look at you, you just look like nothing but a hustler. And I asked him, does it ever feel like that? He was like, if I'm being honest, it always does. And why is that? It's because there is no blessing of God upon your life. There is no hand of God upon your life. Like, you have all these finances, which is great, but it's a tainted 100%. It's a tainted, wasted, filthy 100%. So it doesn't matter how much money you get, you will always be nothing but a hustler. Why? Because there is no faith and there is no trust in God. And this is why it is so crucial and so important that we have the spirit of generosity, that in everything that we do, in everything that we are, and this is why Pastor Bert always says, the lowest form of giving is your finances. Listen, we can come here week after week. I can give a testimony every week. Sia can give a testimony every week. Kalef or Tristan can give a nice tithes and offering testimony every week. But the thing is, if you aren't able, if you find it hard and you find it difficult to give of your finances, and if your excuse is, I'm young, listen, your excuse will be, I'm young, when you're married with kids and your wife asks where the rent money is. That was a bit too much. I apologize. But if your excuse is, I'm young now, listen, I'm young cannot be an excuse for you living a haphazard, filthy, tainted, smelly, pathetic, good-for-nothing life. How long are you planning on being young for? If, and I wish so badly that I got this when I was in high school, because my parents are pastors, so over and over, they would smack it into my brain that you need to tithe, you need to tithe, you need to tithe, and I did. Every opportunity I get, 10%, I put it away, but I had no idea what I was doing. I hate the fact that it took me going through life to understand. And here's the thing. For me,
trying not to brag here, but
for me, tithing hasn't been an issue because it's ingrained in me. I know I get money, I give 10% away. I get money, I give it away. I know. But when I was dealing with this and I was going to my pastor and asking, Pastor, I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. I don't know how I'm going to do about this. The moment my pastor helped me realize that it's the hand of grace and the hand of God upon my life, the moment I realized that and I stopped stressing about the amount of money in my bank account and I started stressing about the amount of people in my car on the way to the vault, is the less I worry about the petrol. I love how when I mention there's money in my account, there's just amens. But when it's I drove wherever to pick up people, it is quiet. Why? It's because our priorities are messed up. Forgive me for saying this, but we couldn't care less about people. We care more about what's happening in our bank accounts. And the problem with that is because we're not willing to give of our finances, we're alone at the service tonight. It's funny, but it's sad. When's the last time any of us got on our phones and decided to Uber someone here? When's the last time any of us decided, let me spend a week, raise some money, 100 rand. I know some people don't live far. Get 100 rand together, Uber a person here. Because we tend to have a lot of excuses for why we aren't giving. But do we have excuses for why people are going to hell? Because that's what it's about. How far are you willing to go when it comes to giving of yourself? That's what it means to give of yourself. That's what it means to give of yourself. That look, I don't know where the money's going to come from. You know what? It's actually, I don't care where my money's going to come from. I just know that people need to get to church. So I'll do whatever it takes to get them to church. And you know what? Since a lot of y'all are young here, I will challenge you to stretch your faith. Pastors, forgive me for this. But what if you randomly call your pastor? Pastor, I have 5 people waiting for me at the bus stop. I need some Uber money. Help me out. All the pastors and all the campuses, forgive me, but we need this. That's what it means to give of yourself. It means I'm no longer preoccupied with myself. I'm no longer preoccupied with my problems. I woke up and I realized that when I started focusing less on what I'm dealing with, when I started focusing less on my problems, when I started focusing less on God, I'm trying to do this, and I shut my mouth just for a minute, and I allowed God to work. And I allowed God to send me. And I said, God, where do you want me to go? God, who do you want me to save? God, who do you want me to pick up? When that was my focus, suddenly everything else came. Suddenly everything else came. I didn't have to worry. Why? Because I decided that I'm going to seek first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness. And it's not about being focused on the things, because many a times we read that verse. We read that verse and we're focused on the things. We're like, okay, as long as I seek God, the things will come. Seek God, the things will come. Forget about the things. Forget about the things. What is God telling you to do today? In fact, what has God told you to do a long time ago? There's a lot of people here where God has told us to do some stuff. And sometimes, believe it or not, you might not like this, God comes in the form of your leader. There's a lot of stuff that your leader has told you to do. That a faith challenge that he has placed on you. What has your leader told you to do that you have not done because you do not have the faith or you have an excuse for why not to? God is calling us. December or no December, God is calling us. Chances are there are more people going to hell in December. But no, it's fine. I need to go to Groove. So what has God asked you to do? What has God called you to do? You in the building. You streaming on YouTube, on Zoom, in every campus. What has God called you to do tonight? And once again, I'm not saying we're oblivious to the fact that all of us go through stuff. Look, we all go through stuff. We're all dealing with stuff. That is the harsh reality of life. We're all going through stuff. We're all going through something. I can't begin to fathom what half of you are going through. But in spite of that, what is Jesus saying? He's saying, trust me. Give of yourself and watch God open the floodgates of heaven and pour out a blessing that you cannot contain. Amen? I'm just going to take this moment to ask for every eye closed and every head bowed. And I don't want to take this moment and I don't want to take this night for granted. Where a lot of you are here and you're like, okay, listen, I hear what you're saying, but I don't know how to get to that place. I don't know how to get to that place where I'm just fully dependent, fully depending on God, where all my hope, all my trust is in God. Once again, I know that everyone here is going through something. We all are. We all are. Whether you're sitting in the auditorium, wherever you're streaming from, whatever campus you're in, whether you're on the cameras, whether you're in the media room, we're all going through something. We all have something to complain about. But more than that, one thing needs to scream louder than that, and that is us seeking the kingdom of God. But before we can seek the kingdom of God, we need to seek God. We cannot begin to have a revelation and understanding of the kingdom of God, of His righteousness, and all the things that follow if we do not have an understanding of who God is. If we don't have a revelation and understanding of God as our Father, then this promise does not apply to us. Then we will remain slaves. We will remain slaves. But God says, I sent Jesus to set you free. I sent Jesus to set you free. From whatever's been holding you tonight, from whatever's been keeping you captive, from whatever's been keeping you from accomplishing the purpose and the plan of God for your life. God says, I sent my son Jesus. John 3:16. That's the verse we opened with. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So right now, where you are, whether it's in the building, whether you're joining us over YouTube, in the campuses, wherever you are, if this is you today, and you're saying, I want to be a child of God, I want to have a revelation of God, I want to walk in this plan, I want to walk in this purpose, I want to seek first the kingdom of God, I want to seek first His righteousness. If that's you today saying, I just need Jesus. If that's you today with no one looking around, I want you to slip up your hand. Just slip up your hand. I see your hand. I see a hand in the building, the campuses, I see a hand. Wherever you are, I see a hand. You can put your hands down. My second cry is for those of you who Maybe you've prayed this prayer before. Maybe you found yourself at that. Maybe you found yourself at that place where, yes, I've been walking a road with God. I've been walking a journey with God, but somewhere along the line, I veered off. Somewhere along the line, I messed up and fell. There was a point I was a lover of God, but at some point in my life, I became a lover of something and everything else. If that's you today and you're saying, I want to come back. I want to come back. I don't pray how I know I'm supposed to pray. I'm not as devoted as I know I'm supposed to be devoted. I don't love the way I know I'm supposed to love. I'm not as committed as I know I'm supposed to be committed. Something is missing and I want to come back. I want to go back. I'm tired of being a hustler. God, I want to come back to you. If that's you tonight, wherever you are, I need you to slip up your hand. I see those hands. I see those hands. I'm going to ask everyone to stand up. Wherever you are, on all the campuses, in all the buildings. And right now, we're just going to take this moment to pray. I'm going to ask everyone to repeat this prayer after me. Just say, Father God, I need you to say it with conviction. I need you to say it like you mean it. Say, Father God, I've heard your word. I've heard that today you have called me. Today, I choose to seek you. I choose to seek first the kingdom of heaven, his righteousness. And I believe that all these things will be added unto me. Jesus, come into my life. Take control. Get rid of this old nature. Live in me. I choose to live for you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Right there where you are, just give God some praise. Father, we worship you tonight. We give you all the praise. We honor you, Jesus. We thank you that it is done in Jesus' name. It is done in Jesus' name. We praise you, O God. We praise you, O God. Okay, right there where you are in the campuses, there are some ushers around. I just need all the ushers to raise their hands. If you made this prayer tonight, it is so important. It is so important that you guys get connected to a leader. It's so important that you guys get connected to a cell. Every single person that you see, every single leader that you see, where whatever campus you are, every single person that you see on stage, we are a product of being discipled. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for our leaders. Lord knows I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for my leader. It's a miracle. It is really a miracle that my leader has had the patience he's had with me. So it is so important that you get connected. So if that is you, if you raise your hand, whether it's in the building, in the campuses, please, our ushers have their hands raised. Please go to our ushers. They'll make sure that you guys are connected. Amen? Amen. Have you guys been blessed tonight? Amen. Amen. Let me just speak a blessing over you. And are you guys going to sing one more song? I have no idea. Y'all sing? No, you ain't singing one more song? Oh, my boy going to be DJ tonight. All right, look at him. That's my disciple there. Look at him in them jean shorts. Are those jeans? Put those knees away, man. Those look like doorknobs. What's wrong with you? I love you. Favorite disciple. Don't tell the rest. All right, let me just speak a blessing over you. Then we're going to have our resident DJ, DJ Takanya. His mixtape will be available never. Let me just speak a blessing over you. May I ask for everyone to have their hands raised. And Father, I thank you for each and every single person here. Every single hand raised, every single cell, every single family represented here. Father, I just speak a blessing upon each and every single person here. Father, today, Lord, we refuse to be slaves. We refuse to be slaves. But Father, today we choose to be your children. We choose to have your heart, the heart of the Father, the heart of a giver. Lord, we declare that everywhere we go, in every sphere, every aspect, every area of our lives, Father, we will be givers, not takers. Whether it be of our finances, of our time, of our resources, and everything, in every single area of our lives, Father, we will be takers. Father, I pray that you help us, Father, in this time and in this season, Father, that we live how you have called us to live. We choose and we decide to seek first the kingdom of heaven and your righteousness tonight. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. All right, God bless everyone. Have an incredible evening and an incredible week. We'll see you same time next week. And yes, before I forget, we have our Vault Rally happening next week, Thursday. I'm thinking about something else. My bad. Next week, Sunday, we have our Vault Rally happening. And it's actually going to be a very special one because our interns, our IP students, will be having an IP takeover titled Ready for War. Listen, they've been preparing for the past couple of months. They've been praying. They've been fasting. It's going to be incredible. You guys do not want to miss it. So invite your world. Invite your world. It is December. That means nothing. That only means the Christmas decorations are coming up. So make sure you guys invite your world. This building is going to be packed to the brim under COVID regulation protocol. Yes, so make sure you guys invite your world. When I say this building, I mean every single building where we are streaming to is going to be packed to the brim. You guys not want to miss it. But once again, we'll see you guys same time next week. And one last time, look what we're going to talk about, the Vault Live right here on the Vault TV.